therapy. We talk about that based on the mutation, you have a like a BRAF mutation or an EGFR mutation. You know, based on this ALK translocation, you can develop a drug. Most of these targeted therapy is directly killing cancer cells. And then in the last lecture, we talk about immunotherapy, right? How do you boost the patient's immune system and use the T cells or whatever, the natural killer cells to kill the cancer cells? It's a very different type of mechanism. And then today we talk about epigenetic therapy. This is kind of an even different type. It's like a tweaking the system balance. I would say a lot of the epigenetic inhibitor, it works well, but for only a very short time. Very often the system will shrug it off, you know, like when you tweak the system balance, later on the cell will try to recover. And so epigenetic therapy on FDA, Inotron has been pretty tricky, but we are trying now to combine the three together, maybe one or two together. If you look at even the TCGA tumors, every tumor is different. Even the same cancer type, some tumors are, you can see, they are DNA methylation phenotype, some of them are immune hot or cold, some of them have different mutations, and the question is, how do you combine them together? So first of all, tumor profile is still important, right? We can do DNA mutation profiling, you can do RNA expression profiling, you can also do this non-ataxic or DNA methylation epigenetic profiling. All of this give us some information about that patient's specific tumor. Do they have immune effect? Do they have mutation? You know, do they have different subtypes and things like that? But also, I hope you can see CRISPR screen is very, very important as well. It's important to identify important drugs in here. And also, all of this generates a lot of data that computational modeling is playing an important role. And so how to really effectively combine all of this together to potentially cure cancer? You know, with one drug alone, I don't think we will really reach the goal. We might have to do very smart, personalized combination. And that's precision medicine, and that's kind of what our lab is doing right now. And so this, we briefly touched on this. Effective drug treatment. If you use just one drug, you know, like a lot of cancers will evolve to be resistant to the cancer. And this original paper, they did some modeling. It's interesting, you know, very often when patients have melanoma, initially you can see that their body has different, you know, melanoma tumors. And when you treat with the BRAF inhibitor, it's totally gone. This patient is completely normal. And then a few months later, all the tumors go back. And interestingly, it was always in the original location. Wherever there was a tumor, it's the exact same location that a tumor grew back. And so a lot of these drugs might be able to kill off, say, 98% of cells in that location. But then that 2% was there. Eventually, the drug-resistant ones are the minority of the clones. And that's why combination therapy can be useful. Because maybe, you know, you use this drug that will kill 98%. You use another drug, maybe it only kills 70%. But there's the overlap is 100, not overlap, the union is like 100%. Then the tumor can really be wiped out. There is a hypothesis that actually a lot of these epigenetic inhibitors, because with cancer cell, you can imagine, the reason is like, it has lost control, the heterogeneity is like very different. And when you use the epigenetic inhibitor, you're pushing the cell to focus on one thing. And then when you add another therapy, that will make the cell really kind of die correctly in some sense, right? So right now with FDA approval, right now with current drug, is, you know, FDA approval, phase one is called a dose escalation. You want to recruit whatever people who want to get involved, just to give them different dose of the drug and look at the side effect and see whether the patient can tolerate. You know, do they have some skin rashes or loose hair or vomit all the time? You know, how bad is the toxicity to the patient? So the phase one usually is evaluating safety. Phase two is evaluating efficacy. Does this drug work better than placebo, and it's no treatment. Phase three clinical trial is really evaluating whether this drug works better than the current standard. state of the art. For example, when a new immunotherapy is introduced, in phase 3 trial is competing with chemotherapy. Is it better than the current state of the art? And so right now, for immunotherapy, most of these drugs are other drugs are trying one at a time. Just try one drug with another drug. The difficulty there is we know for sure the patient will develop resistance. It's kind of almost unethical to give that patient that single drug, because with time, you want to see the effect, you want to see whether it influences patient overall survival. Right? And so you have to keep waiting. If you add another drug, who knows which drug is doing the job, right? So very often, patients are on that drug for a long time unless they show that they progress, the tumor is growing again, they stop responding. But this is really the recipe for failure, and it's probably unethical to treat a patient with that. The successful combination therapy must force the cancer to make at least the 2 mutations in order to become resistant. And that's a lot harder, so we should always think about treating the patient with a combination therapy. The difficulty here is, if you want to do personalized combination therapy, how do you even design a trial? There is currently not a regulation that even allow for it. Say, ah, this patient is this, let's treat with XYZ. That patient is that, let's treat with ABC. You can't design a clinical trial on this. So in order for us to really cure cancer, I think scientists, oncologists, as well as regulation, FDA regulation, needs to somehow work together to really make it happen. Okay? Yeah, so I think that's it. Questions? Peter?
Well, not a question, but a comment. I guess like the thing with sequential therapy is that all of them are targeting one specific clone within a population where you have a heterogeneous population, right? So even though there's like colonial sort of competitiveness, you get rid of one, the other sort of might start.
Currently, it's a sequential therapy. The patient is going on one drug, and then when they become resistant, you kill out the 90% that have that mutation, the remaining one may not have the mutation, or some other mutation happen, right? And then that time you treat with another drug, but this serial way is still not ideal, the best situation. Ideally, you want to do combination from the beginning. That hopefully will wipe out all the cancer cells in one shot. Okay. Other questions? The nice thing about immunotherapy is right now I think everybody agrees that PD-1 is going to be the main thing. All the other therapies, it's hard to actually have another therapy that works by itself. And so it's immunotherapy is very often this drug is combined with PD-1. So so currently there are 2 companies. Keytruda is from Merck, and Nivo is from Bristol Myers Squibb. And so the Keytruda clinical trial is called the Keynote. It's her PowerPoint, the Keynote. And the BMS trials are called Checkmates. And they are running in the order of a few hundred clinical trials now, which is, the pharmaceutical companies themselves are only running a subset of those trials. Most of the other trial is because another company developed another drug, and they say, can we team up with you and treat the patient with your PD-1 plus our new drug in combination? So maybe things are changing a little bit. So with immunotherapy, combinations are more readily accepted now. But personalized combination, that's still hard. All right, other questions? Sorry, I
saw last week there's news that
IDO failed.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Can you give any comments?
Maybe they should better select patients. they should look at tumors. Yeah, so for example, I think Bristol Myers Squibb, when it failed this Checkmate trial, 026, when the PD-1 and the chemotherapy on lung cancer actually didn't perform better than chemotherapy. They are very keen on reanalyzing their data, potentially to rescue that trial and figure out the correct patient subset that might respond to immunotherapy. And so, the student mentioned this IDO trial. So IDO is a gene that is expressed on fetus, because the mom and the baby are not the same DNA. And the mom never attacked the baby. It was because the embryos have IDO to say, okay, don't eat me, signal. You know, it's okay to be foreign. And so a lot of times cancer cells will learn this as well. You can see the cancer cells hijack, they rarely invent anything new. They just hijack what was already present in the organism when the cell was like from small embryo or from infants or whatever, when it's time to grow something. So IDO is this do not eat me, well, kind of molecule from infant as well. And so when there are IDO, the cancer, the immune cell doesn't attack the cancer cells. And so recently there is a combination for a small molecule inhibitor with the PD-1, and that have failed the clinical trials. I don't know whether they have looked at IDO expression, whether they have looked at sometimes the transcription or whatever that gene itself may or may not have a strong enough gene expression signature, but potentially, say, it's like EQTL. If you look at the enhancer, the transcription factor may not be differentially expressed that much, but then the transcription factor's downstream targets can be a much stronger gene expression signature. I don't know whether they look at something like that. IDO is not a transcription factor, though. You need to look for a good signature, maybe stratify the patient, then you go. Thank you. So these are all open questions. Definitely there's a huge interest in making immunotherapy work, and also making more patients respond. Still a huge deal. Okay. Since we still have a little time, would you be interested in hearing some of the recent work that we are doing? It's not published yet, so maybe we don't record that.